Okay, Charles, so we've been talking about temporal difference learning, and in particular, various flavors of the TD Lambda algorithm. Can you remember some of the important things that we touched on?
I think you just said the big one, that all this discussion has really been about temporal difference learning.
And in a nutshell, what's a temporal difference?
Well, it's the difference between things you see on different times, subsequent time steps.
Yeah, different, what kind of things in different time steps?
Reward.
Sort of the difference in value estimates as we go from one step to another, right?
That's exactly right. Because value is just a nice summary statistic for long-term reward.
Good. All right.
But
And
actually, I think it was important that you started off talking about this is the thing that we wanted to do, but first you put it in context by talking about different ways that we could solve the reinforcement learning problem. And as I recall, there were sort of three ways to think about it: model-based learning, value-based learning, and then let's say policy-based learning.
that's right. And TD methods kind of fall where?
The value-based.
All right. And then we dove into the update rules themselves. So what do we talk about there?
Well, we actually derived.
Derived?
That seems either one of those things. It's just
Okay.
semantics. This kind of incremental way of building up estimates of the values, and I think you called it outcome-based. And I suppose, and all that really means, of course, is that you actually look at the outcomes of what you experience from different trajectories and episodes through the space, and you use that to build up your sort of estimate of what the values of various states are.
Yeah, and in particular, the idea of an outcome-based says, well, you can kind of treat reinforcement learning as a kind of supervised learning. Just wait for time to stop and see what happened and use that as a training example. But we can't really wait for time to end because it's kind of too late to use any of the information there. So what we want are incremental methods, methods that can actually do updates along the way that would be equivalent to waiting to the end, but actually gives us results sooner.
Right. And there was a technical point that you made that I guess is something that we learned about, which we had talked about in the old machine learning course, but we didn't go into any detail about, which is this sort of incremental update by making it look like a supervised learning rule, just look like the normal perceptron update rule. And it had a learning rate. And in order for us to be sure that we were going to learn something we wanted to learn, that learning rate had to have certain properties.
Right, that's exactly right. And in a nutshell, what were these properties that the learning rate had to have?
Well, let's see that the sum over all the learning rate values, so let's call that alpha t for time, needed to be infinite. And that the sum of the learning rate squared needed to be finite.
Yeah, and
Rigid.
so intuitively, we wanted learning rate sequences that would allow us to move the value to wherever it needed to go to converge, but would dampen over time, decay, so that the estimates wouldn't keep bumping around as a function of the noise.
Right, I think that's great. Well, anyway, I think that pretty much brought us to the end. I mean, we took a lot of slides to get there, but it turned out the algorithm that we derived looked a lot like something we call TD1. We gave it a nice little name. And TD1 was very nice, except it was inefficient in the way that it used data.
Yeah, I don't know that everybody would agree exactly with that way of characterizing it, but it is true that it had this sort of weird property that it was there was a lot of variability in it. There was a very high variance because if we had one run, we had a value that we were estimating from one place and the estimate was based on a very noisy example, then we're going to have a very noisy estimate. It wasn't going to be able to use the rest of the examples that it's seen to kind of smooth this out.
Right, it just sort of didn't use information along the way. It used information sort of at the end of every episode. And that's what made it sort of data inefficient. And I guess in the end, that gives you high variance. But we came to the rescue, and when I say we, I mean you, came to the rescue with TD0, which has the nice property that it gives you the maximum likelihood estimate.
I prefer to think of it as the Michael Littman estimate.
Yeah, I know you do. I've seen how you snuck that in. And then it got us to the very end, which is good because you're running out of space on the slide. We generalize TD1 and TD0 into something we call TD lambda.
Right. That has the property that when lambda is 0, we get TD0. When lambda is 1, we get TD1. And what about the intermediate values?
Well, then that just gives you a dubstep.
Wait, what?
It gives you dubstep. You get the dubstep look ahead.
I see. That's right. Multiple steps of updates. I see what you mean by dubstep. Like double the number of steps.
Oh, yeah. I like that. That sounds like I meant to do that. Yeah, let's go with that. And there you go. I think that's just about everything. Oh, one more thing is that you talked a little bit about different values of lambda and why you might choose one value over the other. And it turns out that values of lambda between, 0.3 and 0.7 empirically seem to work pretty well.
Yeah, because it somehow is making a nice trade-off between giving the, estimating the right kind of quantity and estimating it using, the values that you get from looking ahead.
Right. And that's kind of, first off, that's neat because otherwise you wouldn't need to have TD lambda. But it's in some ways a little surprising.
Why is that?
Well, because it just kind of works out the way that you would want it to work out. You went through all this trouble to kind of generalize between things. You have this kind of highly nonlinear way of combining all the different k-step look-aheads. And it turns out that combining them so it's not quite zero, it's not quite one, is better than either zero or one. And often that's not how it works, right? I mean, often it's like a line from zero to one is better. It's like a line or it gets really better than it sort of flattens out towards the end, like you said. But in this case, it just gets better and better and better. And then it starts to get worse when you go from one end to the other.
Yeah, that's right. So often when you combine two good things, you get the worst of both. And in this case, it does somehow manage to get the best of both.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
All right. So what I would like to dive into next is a deeper understanding of how we could show that these kinds of methods actually converge and they actually produce optimal estimates and optimal behavior in the limit. And so we're going to take a step back and look at the Bellman equation again to do that.
Oh, I like it. I love the Bellman equation.
All right. See you then.
All right. See you. Bye.